Greetings, my name is Sarian Lee from the U.S. Department of Education Office of Post-Secondary Education Gear Up and Talent Search Program. And we're here today at the U.S. State Department with the Bureau of Cultural Affairs and the Youth Exchange Programs. Today's Google Hangout is called Bring Global Competencies to Your Classroom and Opportunities for Study Abroad to U.S. Students. This webinar is specifically for U.S. educators and teachers and people who have direct contact with students to help them learn about three really awesome programs offered by the U.S. State Department specifically for high school students in the United States. This is a joint partnership between the U.S. Department of Education and the U.S. Department of State, and we have an amazing panel to tell us about their experiences studying abroad with the students. And we're going to start it off with Ms. Michelle Peters, who comes to us from the Youth Exchange Program. So Michelle, tell us a little bit about all the programs that you guys offer and what differentiates them.
Sure, good afternoon. The U.S. Department of State offers over 1,000 competitive merit-based study abroad scholarships each year to American high school students who are ages 15 to 18 years old. We welcome students from diverse backgrounds and those with disabilities to apply. We offer both short-term and long-term programs, and these cultural and educational programs include activities such as community service and visits to cultural and historical sites. Students live in homestays with families to experience the culture firsthand, and previous language study is not required. I'll highlight the three largest programs and for which we have representatives here with us today. The first one is Congress Bundestag Youth Exchange, CBYX for short, and that brings that takes students from the U.S. to Germany for an academic year. Students attend language classes and a German high school. And CBYX was initiated in 1983 in celebration of the 300th anniversary of the first German immigration to the United States, and it's jointly funded between the U.S. Congress and the German Bundestag. The next one is the Kennedy Youth Exchange and Study Program, Yes Abroad, and that awards 65 students a scholarship to study in high school for an academic year. This year they're going to go to Bosnia-Herzegovina, Ghana, India, Indonesia, Malaysia, Morocco, Oman, South Africa, Thailand, Turkey, Macedonia, and the Philippines. And Yes Abroad was initiated as a reciprocal exchange of the Yes program, which brings international students from over 40 countries to the United States each year to live with host families and attend high schools. And they're from significant Muslim populations, as the program was founded in the aftermath of 9/11. And then we have the National Security Language Initiative for Youth, NSLY, and that program is designed to teach intensive foreign language to American high school students overseas. And these are critical languages critical to our national security interest. And they include Arabic, Chinese, Russian, Hindi, Korean, Persian, and Turkish, and that program offers both summer and academic year programs, and all of these programs make their applications available in the fall, and they're open in the fall and winter for application.
Awesome. So basically, there's the Congress Bundestag program if you want to stay with the family. There's the National Security Language program if you want to learn a critical language across the world. And then there's the youth exchange, where you get to actually experience Muslim culture and a more deeper cultural experience. So that's really awesome. Now we're going to introduce the students. These are people who've actually experienced these study abroad programs. So we have Ms. Madeline Conaway, Liana Dodge, Anjali Belur, Nathan Heinrich, and Alan Evans. Can you guys tell us about who you are, where you're from, and where did you study?
Hi everyone, my name is Madeline Conway. Hi. So I'm of Austin, and 11 in 2012 in Fürth, Germany, as a CBYX scholar.
Hi, I'm Nathan, and I studied abroad with the National Security Language Initiative for Youth in China in 2011 to 2012.
Hi, I'm Anjali. I'm from Bethesda, Maryland. I studied abroad in Turkey with the Yes Abroad program in 2011-2012.
Hi, my name is Liana. I'm from Wisconsin, and I studied abroad to Thailand with Yes Abroad in 2011-2012.
Hi, my name is Alan, and I studied abroad from Vermont to Germany way back in 2001-2002 with CBYX.
Thank you. So from Thailand to Turkey to Germany, we have a lot of different experiences. And most importantly, we have an educator on the panel who can tell us about how these types of programs have really helped her in the classroom. Introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Jill. I am a former Spanish teacher in the state of Indiana and now a school administrator. And so I've been fortunate enough to be around some of these returnees from each of these great programs.
Thank you. So we're just going to get into the questions. So starting with the students, what are some of the ways that what you learn in school has actually was brought to life when you went to study abroad? We'll start with you, Anjali.
Sure. One thing I'd like to mention is honestly just the skills you learn from living in a foreign country when you have to kind of navigate different cultures and different languages and navigate just dealing with different people. One thing would be just working with people. Working in groups is a huge part of not just the educational experience in America, but also the work experience in America as I start to intern more and think about possibly getting a job in the next few years. And also as I work just on group projects in college, that ability to work well with other people who come from different backgrounds or have different perspectives and work with them in a patient manner is really important and really I was able to cultivate that skill in my year abroad.
Liana.
When you go abroad, it really helps you to realize the different aspects of learning. So when you're first learning, you kind of think of from a singular aspect, how does this affect me? How does this affect my community, my culture, the people that are related to me? But when you go abroad, you learn a different way of looking at things, how it affects more worldly issues and how it affects the community that you're living in there. So when you come back to the classroom, when you're in a history class or an English class and you're reading a book about international text or just a regular book, you have a whole other view on how it affects other people and how it was written and why it was written in such a regard to the society and the community. And it gives you a good insight of how other people deal with issues and how that affects them and their lives.
That's awesome. So Anjali talked about the group work. Liana's talking about getting in-depth and really making the text on page come alive in the classroom. Let's hear from the guys. What else do you guys have to say about your experiences?
Well, I would say that learning Chinese, it's one of the most difficult languages to learn. And if you just learn it raw in a classroom setting without the cultural component to go along with it, it's a lot more difficult to learn, but when you're abroad in China and you're learning about the culture at the same time, and you're learning how things apply to different cultural contexts and when to use something and when not to use a given word or grammatical structure, it really helps you to learn the language a lot faster, along with being immersed in that environment.
Thanks, Alan.
For me, when I returned to high school and then went on to college, I think I got a lot more value out of my time in the classroom. My worldview was much expanded, and that helped me become interested in the content we were studying in classes like history and social studies, rather than just learning something because the teacher happened to have selected it. It became more to life.
Well, the next thing, there's the classroom aspect, but what about the way you interact with your fellow students, classmates, and the teachers? So, Maddie, can you tell us a little bit about how your study abroad affected your relationships with your fellow classmates? How did it help in the classroom?
Yeah, so when I got back from Germany, I decided to apply to boarding school, and I now go to, I'm about to graduate from a boarding school that has 30% of the students are international students, and I felt like after having been an international student in Germany, I could better relate to their experiences, better connect with people of different worldviews and different cultures. And I had a lot more to bring to the table because I'd had experiences that a lot of other students my age had not had at their age, in their age, in that age. And the teachers were amazed by how much I'd grown and was able to contribute. So I think it helped me so much formulate my own opinions and have a better, well-rounded view.
Thank you. And that makes sense. You know, you have an opportunity to grow as an individual, as a student, and you're probably more culturally aware and sensitive to what's going on in the world. So coming back to our educator, our guest educator, Ms. Jill Warner, what do you think that the students brought back that you saw was most valuable in the classroom?
I think probably the biggest thing was just a change in perspective. You know, the way that those students are looking at the things that are being taught in the classroom and their contributions to discussions are coming from a much more global perspective than that of their classmates that have not left the state or the town that they're from. And so it really adds a tremendous amount to any of the classrooms that had any sort of, you know, classroom discussion where these students can participate and share with their classmates. So from your social studies curriculum, where they are able to talk firsthand about their experiences because they've been there or they've met people from there and have that as firsthand relevant information that their classmates can relate to more accurately because it's coming from the mouth of a person of their same age versus just from their teacher. But at the same time, you know, even being able to look at those things through a different lens than what they had looked at those things through before just adds a lot to any classroom environment.
Excellent. Thank you. And it's nice to know as a teacher that what you're doing means something to the students. But what about issues like Common Core requirements and the equivalency? How does an educator navigate that where you want this great experience for the student, but they don't want to miss out on the requirements that they need to actually graduate from high school?
That's a great question, and when you think about the Common Core, you know, it is one of those things that is trying to prepare students for being competitive globally and also getting them ready with their 21st century skills, and part of those skills involve global competence. And so these students returning to the classroom have a much more heightened sense of global competency because they've been in the world. They've experienced the world. They're bringing different perspectives to all the things that they're doing, whether it's their service organizations, whether it's their language classes, their history classes, their math classes, etc. And they're sharing those things with other classmates in the school. And so these students themselves are coming back very prepared with, you know, relevant information and realistic experiences that have changed their lives. But on top of that, they're able to really you know, create some dynamic things going on in tandem with their teachers to broaden that of the rest of the students in their classroom to help promote that idea of global competency to all involved.
And I can say at the U.S. Department of Education, there's a big push to encourage students to seek global opportunities to study abroad. So that's why we're here, because we realize it's more than just competing with your fellow classmate. We're now competing with the world, so we want our students to have an advantage to know what's going on around the world. So what happens when the students come back? And this comes back to the students. Anjali, what happened with your credit situation? Were you able to transfer those credits, and how did you navigate whatever you dealt with when you had to come back and deal with the actual academics of the study abroad experience?
Sure. So I had actually already graduated high school when I went abroad. So I did not need any credits from my high school in Turkey to transfer back to my high school back in Maryland. But I know a lot of people were able, who ended up going on to college straight after their study abroad experience, were able to place out of language requirements and place in the higher language classes. Maryland actually, I'm at the University of Maryland, actually doesn't offer Turkish, so that wasn't an option for me. But I would say taking that year off, or taking, not a year off, but taking a year away from the American school system made me really excited to come back and take all the skills that I'd learned, all the experiences that I'd had into my American style classroom. It just made me really enthusiastic to be back in the American school system.
So you had a different appreciation for what you came from where you came from to where you are.
Sure. Yeah.
Great. Anybody else have any good experiences, bad experiences? What can you tell us about the credit situation after you come back from studying abroad?
So for me,
I
it was
to that. I am.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Okay, Maddie, we're going to hear from you first, and then Liana.
Okay, perfect. So I went to public school for the freshman and sophomore year and decided to spend my junior year abroad. My school really wouldn't give me concrete answers before I left on whether or not I would receive credit. And when I got back, they were similarly vague about it. So I ended up deciding to switch schools when I got back. And I ended up repeating my junior year at a boarding school. But it was honestly the best decision I've ever made, because I got the most amazing experience of my entire life while abroad in Germany, learned German, met so many amazing people, but then also got to have the rigorous junior year that's so critical to college, as everyone wants to tell you. So I think I got the best of both worlds, and honestly, people question why I would ever want to repeat a year of high school, but I think it's ultimately worth it if that's the route you need to go.
Wow, what a sacrifice. Well, a sacrifice and a gain. Liana, how about you? How was your experience?
My experience was awesome. I actually did repeat as well, but I repeated for personal reasons. I wanted to go to a specialty boarding school about environmental stewardship, but actually they gave me credits for everything except for English, which is relative to the country you go in. So Thailand, you know, speaks Thai, so their English classes weren't as high as our English classes here, so they didn't give me credit for that. But they did give me all of my language credits, where in my state you need 2 language credits to graduate, so that's 2 years of language. They gave me all of them for 1 year abroad, because I took Thai 1, Thai 2, conversational Thai, and writing Thai. So at my school I took a lot of Thai, so they gave me actually 2.5 years of Thai credits, so I had all my language credit fulfilled. They gave me credit for all my science classes, all of my history classes, my social studies. They gave me a lot of volunteer credits, because with the Yes Abroad, you do a lot of community service, so they gave me a lot of those kind of credits too. So it was really cool. My credits definitely rolled over, and the only one that I had to redo was an English one, which isn't true for all countries, because not all the countries you go to are non-English speaking.
Wow. That's really interesting. The community service component is something I didn't know about either. How about, now Nathan, you said you had a good experience with your credits, correct?
My situation was slightly difficult, because my family actually moved while I was studying abroad. So the credit situation changed when I went from my original state of Wisconsin to Texas, because Texas has much more stricter graduation requirements. But it's definitely something that can be worked out with your counselor prior to going abroad. That's definitely within reach. And a lot of credits that you obtain abroad can be negotiated. I know some people that I was studying abroad with in China who took art classes like calligraphy and whatnot, and they were able to translate that back to fine arts credits. But I would really say that despite not being able to gain as much credits as you might think you would like to obtain before you go to the country, I still think that the benefits far outweigh the costs. You're learning stuff that you will not be able to learn anywhere else. The cultural skills are just immense.
Thank you. Alan, do you have anything else you want to contribute?
Sure, yeah. I elected to go abroad, or I applied to be selected to go abroad after my junior year, and I too worked with my high school before departure. They weren't really sure, since they hadn't worked with sending students abroad before. So when I returned, I brought back samples of my coursework and statements about my German language ability and so on. And that really impressed them, and they ended up giving me a lot of credits. And I actually completed my senior year after I came back from studying abroad. And so I began college a year later than I otherwise would have. However, I was planning on taking a gap year anyway, and so the study abroad opportunity kept me engaged academically, and I gained the cultural skills and the language skills and still started university at the same time. So it worked really well for me.
That's excellent. And Jill, do you have any suggestions for the educators out there when it comes to helping the students negotiate and create a curriculum that matches what the schools want to see, specifically with community service? Almost every school has a community service component, and it's awesome that the Yes Abroad incorporates that into the program. What can you say to teachers or educators who, hearing these stories, might not even know how to come to the table with something that works for the student?
I think probably the biggest and best thing I can say to get everyone started is work with the students. If you can identify the students who are traveling when they choose to participate in these programs, to work with them prior to their departure, to help them know what documents you're going to need when they return. So if your school is going to need a transcript that is translated into English when they come back, that is easier for them to take care of while they're abroad many times than for them to get that done when they're coming back based on the languages and such that they are learning while they're gone. The other part of that is when they have the information before they leave that they need a syllabus for their class, so that you'll be able to identify what the topics are that were covered in that class. You can see how it matches up with the course description for your state or for your school. They need to know that before they go. Those are things that are much harder for them to track down after they come back from that experience, because then they've got to try and work to communicate with their teachers from abroad and so on and so forth. Once the kids return and they hopefully have been able to bring some of these documents back with them, then it's a matter of looking at the course descriptions, looking at the numbers of hours that they spent learning that curriculum and learning that content, and seeing where they can fit in your state's course description guides. Similarly, if they took, for example, a math class that you would think it is equivalent to Algebra 2, for example, or pre-calculus or something like that, for you to be able to look at the topics that they covered, and if the amount of time that they spend in the course may only line up with a semester's equivalency in your school, have them take a final exam or something, some sort of test or exam to show that they have gained a level of mastery or competency in that content area, for you to be able to demonstrate that, yes, they do deserve some credit for their for the work that they spent a semester or a year doing while they were gone. The same thing goes for some of the language components. And if you really evaluate what course descriptions are out there, there are courses that exist that relate to like intense cultural learning and things like that through some sorts of vocational aspects. So you can look at those, and if you work with the students before they go, there's ways that they can build portfolios and photo portfolios through blogs and things like that while they're gone, that they can bring all of that information to you with some journaling and so on. And you can have them do a few things to show their competency and their mastery of that content when they come back. So there are ways to be flexible with all of that, especially if you have the opportunity to talk to the kids and work with them before they go, because then they can be prepared while they're gone to gather whatever materials you need. Guidance counselors are exceptionally helpful in that regard to help students kind of look at what those courses could be and what they need to graduate.
Great tips. Those sound like best practices. So if you're listening out there, get your transcripts together, work with a guidance counselor, start to look at the curriculum content, and determine with your guidance counselor, your teacher, whoever's going to determine the equivalency courses, what is mastery? How do you know that you've mastered this course so that it can transfer? Liana, tell us something else that you think might help.
It really helped for me that I talked to my guidance counselor before, but then also while I was abroad, I sent her like samples of what I was doing, and I kept in contact with her, and I told her what I was doing, and I asked her how those would correlate to like the American credits and what they go towards. So while I was abroad, I had contact with her, I mean, it wasn't hard, maybe 3 times, and I kind of just told her where I was at and what I was doing, and that really helped her to be able to gauge how many credits I got and what they were applied towards, and she said that was one of the main reasons I was able to get all the credits that I was able to get. So just having like a little bit of contact, even having like sending it to your mom and your mom shows your guidance counselor, it really helped with getting the credits that I got.
Yeah, because you want to focus on school. You want to focus on your experience. So it is nice to have some supportive people in place to help you get through it. So we have a couple more questions. I want to find out, what cultural skills did you learn abroad that you couldn't have learned in the classroom? So anybody can jump in at this point.
I would say gaining a very firm understanding of social relationships was something that I found to be very crucial when I was studying abroad in China. Chinese culture is very complex, and the way people interact in like in different cultural contexts, it's really important to understand when interacting and just speaking the language. For instance, the Chinese concept of saving face and status and whatnot is very dissimilar to what we do here in America. For instance, in the classroom setting there, it's frowned upon to correct the teacher if there's something wrong with what she's doing on the board. It's very much frowned upon, and you will look very terrible if you say something to them and make them embarrassed in front of the class. So it's definitely one of the things, and it's also very instrumental to like their societal structure, this concept of saving face. And that's one of the things that it's really hard to understand, but when you go abroad to countries like China, you get to experience that firsthand and develop a very firm grasp of how to apply those sort of cultural issues.
Wow, I hope you didn't make that mistake of correcting the teacher.
No. Fortunately, I did not.
Okay, who's next?
If I could jump in, I would say patience and persistence, if I like to be a little bit broad, were two skills that I really gained while I was abroad that I was able to apply to my life here. Dealing with a culture where you don't really speak the language really takes a lot of persistence and patience in that. You're constantly having to be corrected, and you're constantly having to learn that you've just done something wrong, and that you've just that you have to correct it, and that you have to do it better or change completely what you thought was right or what has been right for you for 18 years. And so dealing with that takes a lot of patience, and I think that kind of builds your character once you get back and realize that, you know, like, maybe my way of doing things isn't always correct. Like, there are different scenarios in which doing things a different way makes it much more fruitful for the outcome. I think that was something that I really touched on when I was abroad and I learned to come back.
Thank you. Patience and persistence. That's a great quality because you're going to need that when you go into post-secondary education. Maddie.
Yeah, I think going off that is kind of just learning that taking risks is totally worth it. And being able to laugh at your mistakes. I went to Germany without literally speaking a word. I didn't know how to say hello. Probably should have learned some basic German before I left. But it was summer, and I wanted to be at the beach with my friends. When I got over there, I stumbled over saying simple sentences and things like that. And it made the Germans laugh. And I eventually started to laugh. And then when they would explain to me my mistakes, and Germans are very confrontational and will tell you that you're wrong, and you kind of just, it builds your skin. And I don't think I had ever experienced something like that in America before, but I am so lucky that I got to experience it over in Germany. It made me so much stronger and willing to make a mistake because, you know, saying something wrong in German, you're not going to die just because you say, like, I love something really weird. So I think that's something that I never would have learned in America, but I definitely learned instantly in Germany.
Thank you. Anybody else have any contributions?
I think a huge thing that I learned when I was abroad in Thailand is, like China, they have a huge respect for their elders and saving face and respect for each other. And I think when I was in Thailand, I learned a lot about how in America we definitely value time is money and money is time. In Thailand, it's completely the opposite. They think that if you're doing something you love, it doesn't matter how much time you're spending doing it or what you're doing. And it gave you more of a relaxed sense of appreciating the people around you, appreciating the little things in life. So I really learned how to appreciate maybe just being in the classroom and having a teacher make a joke instead of always being serious. It was appreciating the little things, taking a walk on your own. It helped me really to dig deeper into what I wanted to do and what made me happy as a person rather than thinking about all the different, you know, I have to be a lawyer because I have to make a lot of money. I have to do this because society wants me to do this. It took away the social norms and the social pressures that I have here in America, and it let me really see who I was and what I wanted to do with my life, completely disregarding money and, you know, what everybody else in my country would want to do or what, you know, society says I should do. So it gave me, like, a completely different perspective on what life is really about for me rather than thinking about social media and everything like that. It really helped me to grow as a person and really mature as to what I really wanted to do.
Wow. Someone, a teenager who is not pressed about being on social media. That's phenomenal. But speaking of social media, if you are on Twitter, you can hashtag GoAbroadWebinar. If you have any questions, any thoughts, if you want to share this with people, if you're a teacher, a principal, anybody in the community who really wants to get your students involved. And Nathan, before I go to you, I want Jill to tell us a little bit about what she sees in her students.
Thank you. As I'm listening to all of the students talk about the cultural things and the perspectives that they gleaned while they were abroad, it really makes me think of the students that I've encountered from these programs that have come home. And they just have a much more heightened sense of awareness and acceptance of others that they're around and cultural differences. And in a school environment with all of the social cliques and the bullying and all of those different things that are going on and the pressures to use social media, it's so refreshing as an educator to have these students come back and to, you know, infuse this awareness and this acceptance among their circle of friends in the classroom and around the school building, because it really adds a lot to just the peacefulness in a school setting.
And you talked about maturity. I mean, when you have a student who has to navigate another country on their own, like Maddie said, making mistakes and realizing it's not the end of the world, that you can laugh it off, it builds a sense of self that I think students, it takes you to the next level, which is, of course, post-secondary education. And as someone from the Department of Education, I want to know, for those of you who are in college, studying at a university, how do you see this study abroad experience helping you in college?
I'll chime in there, if I may. When I was abroad, I really was no longer surrounded by people who worked the same way as me or were very similar to me. And so when coming back and going to university after I finished up high school, I really found that I was able to leverage different people's strengths better when working in a group. Instead of sort of working in a group and seeing different people were doing things different ways and thinking to myself, that won't do, I'll just take it all on myself and we'll do it this way. I was able to, you know, more manage everyone's strengths and use that to sort of to build a group and to take advantage of everyone's skills.
Thank you. And Nathan, can you tell us, we kind of skipped over you. You had something else you wanted to share with us.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that in addition to like all the cultural knowledge that you obtain in learning a language abroad, at the same time, I think full immersion is one of the most important qualities of the program. At least I know the National Security Language Initiative for Youth, that is definitely very language intensive. And one of the advantages of learning a language abroad is that you're completely surrounded by the language. Everyone around you is speaking the language. And so you really have no choice but to use the language. Learning a language in the United States here, I know a lot of kids have the tendency to just to directly translate things from English into their target language. But being abroad, you kind of, it's exactly the reverse. Like, there's a lot of things after coming back from China, I don't know how to translate them into English. I just know how, like, what they mean literally. So that's definitely something that stood out to me as being very important and helping me a lot in learning Chinese while I was abroad.
Thank you. Anybody else? Anything you want to share about the whether or not you are going to college or on your way and you see a difference in how you can deal with challenges or if you're still in high school? Anything that you think is really important for students who are in the application process to know?
For me, it really helped. Oh, I'm sorry. For me, it really helped me to understand. Actually, I'm not going to, I am going to go to college, but right now I have like a job. And it really helped me to understand that the job that I wanted wasn't just like, you know, a fast food job or something. I mean, it took me a lot longer to find a job that I wanted, but I found a grassroots campaign that helps with like, you know, social issues, and it's a nonprofit, and it's really good to be able to find a job and work with something that has that. And the Yes Abroad, having gone abroad and then after going abroad and doing like leadership training and going to orientations, like the jobs that you look for and the schools that you're looking at, they really respect that, and they think really highly of people that go abroad and do things like that, because it shows that you're taking the initiative to do something more and to be something more, and that you really care, and it really shows how much you care not only about your community but the communities of other states and other countries, and it shows that you care more than just, you know, inwardly, you care outwardly, and that really shows and really helps when you're applying for almost anything that you want to do.
That's beautiful, and it's important. I mean, at the end of the day, we do want to get jobs, you know, so it's good to have that long-term goal and to be very clear about what you want to do once you leave the program. And just a reminder, this program is absolutely, these programs are absolutely free. So for the students and the teachers, know that the students have an opportunity to go abroad on the federal government's dollar, so take advantage of this unique opportunity. Maddie, tell us about what else you wanted to contribute.
Yeah, so like I said earlier, going abroad taught me to take risks, and I'm actually going to be studying at the University of St. Andrews in Scotland for the next 4 years, which if you'd asked me freshman year that I was going to be going to college in Europe, I would have like laughed in your face. So I think that it gave me a worldview and made me realize that I'm not locked into the American system. I can go and take risks and go abroad for 4 years instead of just one. I fell in love with Europe in general when I was over there, and I have to go back, so, yeah.
Wow, Maddie, you're a little bit of a renegade, huh? Okay, anybody else have anything they want to say before I move on to the next question? So the next question, what obstacles did you face before going abroad, and what was your decision process like when it came to your family, your friends, just in general? And Jill, I would hope that you can chime in on this. How can teachers also help students through that decision-making process? Because this is a pretty mature step. Like Maddie said, most students want to go to the beach for their summer or, you know, play sports, but you're sacrificing a lot to live abroad. So Jill, we'll start with you. What kind of obstacles do you think students face when having to make this transition?
I think probably the biggest one is the thought of giving up their friends for their time abroad. And I think probably the biggest thing for the students to keep in mind is, you know, their friends will still be there and they're still going to be able to connect with them. And lifelong friendship is still going to be there even with a break when a student goes abroad for a short period of time, because in the grand scheme of things, a semester and a year abroad is a short-term thing. And I know in high school it seems like a long time because it's that full academic year, a whole semester, but in the grand scheme, it really is a short period of time. And what they gain from that, I think it's really kind of that cost-benefit analysis to help the students go through, is to really look at the fact that they're going to come home with a group of friends that they've connected with, that they have so much in common with. when they're in high school, many times they are locked into a friend group that came from their same community based on where their parents chose to live. And when they take off on this experience, they're connecting with other students that are going for the same reasons they are, to glean cultural information, to learn a language, and to have a new life experience. And so the common bond that forms between these students when they're abroad is tremendous. And those really become some great relationships that these students are able to carry on. On top of that, because these are homestay experiences and these students are coming from, you know, the high school age, they still rely on that host family as far as guidance and learning their way around and help answer some of those cultural questions they have and don't know who else to turn to, and sometimes even questions that they have about what they're studying at school. And so their bonds with the host family are tremendous, so they really have a second family now in another country. And so, you know, when you're really able to sit back and think about the advantages that brings in a life context, it's huge over, you know, going to the movies and, you know, sitting on the couch chatting about this or, you know, doing the things that they would normally spend their summer or evening and weekend time doing away from, you know, their hometown during the time that they're abroad.
Wow, that's important. Anybody else? What do you think are some of the biggest things that you have to think about before you leave?
If I could chime in there, I would say one piece of advice I would give to anybody going abroad is to kind of nix having any expectations low or high about what the experience is going to be like, because if you talk to any exchange student with one of these programs or otherwise, everyone's exchange experience is very different, whether it comes from how they relate to the city, how they relate to their host family, how they relate to their host country friends. Everyone has a really different experience, and I think it's important to go into the experience with a really open mind and a lot of positivity, because really the only thing that will get you through all of it, and all the good parts and the bad parts, because there will be both, is a lot of positivity and kind of not going in with, well, my experience is definitely going to be like this. I'm definitely going to get along really well with my host family, but not very well with my friends. Or I'm definitely going to have to make a lot of friends like all at once, but try and spend a little bit less time with my host family, because really you can't predict what's going to happen once you get there. So it's just really important to approach everything with a really positive attitude.
Great, great point. Have a positive attitude, building networks. Anybody else?
This is actually advice that Alan gave my entire group right before we left for Germany. And he drew a picture of there's like two different worlds and then drew a picture of like a person. And he told us to make sure we had both feet in Germany instead of trying to straddle both like America and Germany. And whether that was through contacting your friends and family back home, being really active on social media and like watching your friends go to junior prom and stuff like that. And that was probably the best advice I got, was to basically just like jump into the situation or your new environment wholeheartedly and just, you know you're missing stuff back home, but if you really just jump in, that you will gain so much out of that experience that it doesn't matter what you're missing.
Great advice. I guess the next question I want to find out is, has this helped you get clear on what you want to study in college? Does anybody have a feel really confident, or do you have a little bit better of idea what you think might hold your interest for the next 4 years?
I personally think it really has. Like I said, I went abroad right before I started college, and it really, one of the things I loved doing when I was abroad was really talking to Turkish people about the Turkish government and what they thought about the U.S. government and what they thought about U.S. culture and what they thought about Turkish culture, and that was honestly one of my favorite parts. And coming back to the U.S. and realizing that there's a lot of positions available that are based on that concept of talking to people and getting people's perspectives on what their government is like and what our government is like, especially within a lot of think tanks. A lot of it is based on getting, like within Washington, a lot of it is based on getting the kind of Washington perspective on certain countries, because they don't really get that over there, as opposed to, sorry, I'm not sure if I'm making myself clear. Like, right now I'm interning at the Middle East Institute, and a big part of what we do is try and get the Washington perspective on the ongoings of what's going on over there. And what I did when I was abroad as a YES student really correlated to that in terms of getting the perspective of people in country.
So basically that cross-cultural understanding from a political perspective, not just the community, but also seeing how governments work in comparison to how our governments work. That's beautiful, Anjali. Anybody else have more clarity in about what they want to study as a college student? All right, we're going to move on to the next question. And this question asks, what are the benefits of a gap year? So if you do find yourself having to take a year off, it's not common for most students, but what do you think are some of the things that students can look forward to in the event that they do take that year off? And Maddie and Alan talked a little bit about that. So if either of you want to share the benefits.
Yeah, I can go. So I didn't really know that my year was going to be a gap year in the middle of my high school career when I was deciding to go abroad. But I really think it focused me. It taught me a lot of other skills that really helped me study and have better study habits when I got back from Germany. I also was much more mature than a lot of my classmates when I got back, and I think that is something that would be great for going after high school. It was a little tough to come back into the American high school system, having gone abroad and studied abroad and been really independent, and then having 2 years of high school left to go, and a lot of my friends who were from America on my year abroad were taking gap years, and so it was a really nice transition for them to go and have this experience where they learned a lot about independence and things like that and then go straight into college. So I think it prepares you well for a more independent lifestyle.
Thank you, Maddie.
I think along those lines, a lot of students I found when starting university took maybe a semester or a year to socialize to the environment and the expectations at university. And those of us who had studied abroad in high school really had a leg up because we'd already gone to a place that felt so foreign to us at first and made ourselves a home there. And so that really allows you to leverage your first semester or year in university to make the most of that time academically rather than spending a lot of time just trying to get through the social aspects of being away from home and the logistics of it and so on.
And we actually have a question from a viewer. Thank you, Alan. How can U.S. educators promote study abroad to better compete globally? Only a small percentage of U.S. students study abroad. So basically, Jill, I think you'd be the best person to chime in on this. What can teachers do? How can we better engage students to learn about these programs? And Michelle, if you want to talk more about how teachers can contact you to get information, you can do that as well. But Jill, yes, what do you think is missing, or what do you think we can add to the global study abroad conversation for high school students?
I think probably the first and biggest part is to make sure that the teachers know what's out there. I think in so many school scenarios, when I talk to other teachers, they're like, whoa, I didn't even know about that. So I think them just being a part of this webinar today is a tremendous great step forward. Because they're educating themselves about what opportunities are out there for their students. Beyond that, help them. They need to get the word out to the other teachers because, you know, one teacher in any given semester can impact or publicize this to approximately 200 students. When they take that to their entire department or to the staff in the building and really get the word out, they're really now affecting the entire building. It's important not just to think about high school teachers promoting this. Many times these conversations need to start with middle school students and middle school parents. Because a lot of times I found that the students are willing to take that risk and they're willing to go and they'll go through the process of applying for these scholarships and so on and so forth. But their parents are reluctant to be supportive of the experience because of fear or because of their child's age or they're concerned about safety and all of those different things. And the more it's kind of planting that seed as early as possible in the student population and leveraging the corporation or the district mission statement. Because I bet if most teachers and most educators were to look at the mission statement for their school district or school corporation, they're going to see some aspect of it relates to preparing students for the 21st century, preparing students for the global world, preparing students in some way for that next step. And that next step in this day and age includes a global component. And so, you know, they need to leverage that with the rest of their staff so that everybody's aware of what opportunities are out there for students. But on top of that, you know, just become informed and help inform the decision makers around the building and to, you know, to encourage others to learn these types of things so that they are prepared to help students make these decisions to go abroad, how to work with their schedules, how to, you know, help them reach the goals that they have for graduation or a gap year or whatever they're looking to do. There is flexibility out there in states with various courses and so on and so forth. It's just a matter of, you know, wanting to put forth the time and effort to publicize, promote, and be flexible with the students and families that are interested.
Thank you. Great tips. Great tips. Liana.
Yeah, so actually how I wanted to, like, when I was really young, I wanted to go abroad because I was friends with a family who had a foreign exchange student. So it was, I saw the foreign exchange student come here, and I was like, I was six, and I told my mom, Mom, I'm going to do that. So it's really having exchange students in the classroom and in your school, and the teachers emphasizing and, like, sharing what those students do, like having the exchange students do presentations. At my school, I instigated that we had an exchange student week. We had four exchange students, and my high school has 100 kids in it, so that was a big deal. And so we had a whole week where each day in our social studies class, the exchange student would talk about, like, their culture, and then we had, like a game on Friday where we had, like a soccer game where the different countries, you were put in a different country and you played soccer, and it really showed all the students, like, about the exchange student, made them more aware that exchange students are there. And I think that would be a big thing in larger schools where exchange students are kind of just put into the mix in the wash and people don't exactly realize they're exchange students, and to emphasize that exchange students come here and you can go there, and showing that intercultural bonds and intercultural connections really helps to engage students in wanting to be abroad students and wanting to do something like that, and it makes it less scary for them to realize people their own age are doing it too. And if you see it when you're in middle school, then you see that those people are doing that. And I mean, when I was six, I wanted to go abroad, so that was always a dream of mine, and it really helped to see the other exchange students or to have an exchange student.
Wow, it's really hard to add much onto what Joliana has said. That's pretty powerful. And it actually speaks to why the U.S. State Department is funding these programs and why it has such bipartisan congressional support, which is because it is a most valuable tool that we have in our public diplomacy efforts, which further foreign policy goals. I would be very happy to send you resources. We have brochures and posters and magnets to help promote the opportunities to your students. And all you have to do is send me an email at youthprograms@state.gov.
Thank you, Michelle. youthprograms@state.gov. Get your brochures, get your magnets, get everything you need to let the world know, let your community know. Nathan, tell us how you think teachers can do better at letting people know about these programs and supporting students.
Well, as an alumni representative for my program now, actually, for the National Security Language Initiative for Youth, a lot of us representatives have been around the country and have been spreading the word to teachers in classrooms about how they can publicize these opportunities that are available to students to go and learn critical languages like I learned Chinese while they're in high school. I think this is especially important. I've done a lot in my own community and dropping brochures off at schools and talking to classrooms, but I think it's a very important, it has very crucially important to education, in that when you go abroad to a foreign country, and especially when you learn a foreign language like Chinese, it's extremely important, because when you learn languages like Chinese, it gives you insight into their culture. And when you speak in someone in their mother tongue, in their own language, there's a lot more personality that can be conveyed through that, a lot of more familiarity and trust that can be developed. And I just think, like, forming relationships like that and going abroad and learning the language and the cultural skills at the same time, it's drastically important, and it's going to be even more important as our country becomes more, even more interdependent on nations like China, Russia, and the Middle East, where I know my program sends a lot of their kids, and I know there's a lot of other people from programs on this as well, where kids are going to these very strategic countries.
You sound like a future ambassador to China.
Thanks.
Jill, yes, tell us what you have to contribute.
Well, I just, you know, after listening to them, there are more things that I'd just like to share as far as the promotion of all of this and kind of getting the word out, especially after, I think, Liana was talking about having exchange students in the school and how that kind of helps get the word out. I can tell you one thing locally that both my school and I've seen a few others do as well is promoting what is considered like an international opportunities fair. Where you share some of the benefits with the community, invite in elementary parents, middle school parents, high school parents, and students alike. And you can do this on a conference level, a community level, a whole district level, or just one school, for it to be whatever size you want it to be. But, you know, have some of these returnees up there and sharing some things about their experience, because it's motivating to other students who are in the audience. At the same time, you know, have a table if your school has a club fair where students get to know about different extracurricular activities and things like that. Put that information out there at the same time so students see that this is one more thing that they could do and become a part of. On top of that, if the school doesn't have an international club, see if there's a teacher that is interested in sponsoring that, and they can both work with the exchange students who are currently hosted in the building, but bring in all of the returnees as well to engage in those conversations and do different things in the building to promote global awareness, to promote just a variety of different things, but also to help promote the variety of cultural things that they've learned while they're abroad and what opportunities are out there for the rest of the student population.
I love the idea of an international fair. That would be awesome, and I think it'd be a great way for people to get their feet wet, test things out, see what it's like to interface with people who actually have done it, who've lived there, see the benefits. So thanks for that suggestion. One question I'm curious to know is about your families. How did you stay connected with your classmates, your mom, your dad, your guardians, whoever were the key people in supporting you throughout this process? What were some of the struggles that you dealt with and some of the successes that you dealt with?
If I might, I know, I think Maddie mentioned earlier that idea of putting both feet in your host country, and that was something that really spoke to me as an exchange student, and I actually looked for support system within country as opposed to going back to my old support system of maybe my mom or my American best friend or my brother. And I think I started, if I had a problem at school in Turkey, I would go to my host mom, or I would talk to my Turkish best friend, or I would really look for people in country, or even the other American students who were there with me at the time, to support me, as opposed to kind of reverting back to my American support system, because I really felt like when you go back to that old support system, it makes you feel homesick, and it makes you not regret coming, but it makes your problems that you're having in country feel worse than they are.
It's great. So kind of being where you are and leaving one part of your life there and focusing on this part. So that's good advice. Anybody else? Staying connected?
Yeah, I kind of agree with that. I think it's really difficult for other people to relate to what you're going through at home. because none of my friends at home had ever gone abroad. They were all kind of skeptical about why I would want to do that. We always had exchange students at my high school, and everyone loved them. But doing the reciprocal was kind of a foreign thing to them. Obviously, try and keep in contact with your family occasionally, but not too much, because I think, like she just said, it will make you homesick if you are talking to your family very regularly. And just kind of be open to talking to people in your own, your new host country. Keep the other exchange students in your area close by, because they are the only ones that really know exactly what you're going through right then and there. Or alumni from your program are also great resources. I know I reached out to people who had gone on CBUX a couple of years before me when I was having difficulties, and they were able to talk me through the situations and things like that. So I think those resources are critical, and I would definitely try and utilize them.
Thank you. Yeah, I think it's important to see what is available to you and prepare yourself just to be in that space where you're not really sure what might happen. Like Anjali said, I think that's beautiful, not having expectations, and it's a chance for you to step out there on your own. Are there any other really important things that you guys want to share with people, especially as it relates to learning about the program? How did you guys even find out about these programs, and where are the best places that people can go to get it? And I'm speaking to the students, because you guys are the ones who sought it out. Like Liana said, she's had this dream since she was 6 years old. So anybody can tell us, how did you learn about Yes Abroad, the Congress Bundestag program, and the National Security Language Initiative?
Right. So I was actually a senior in high school when I applied, and I mostly just applied on a whim all through high school. I had never planned on going abroad. I really wanted to go to college as soon as I finished high school, and I honestly just applied to procrastinate on my college applications. I was like, well, this seems like a much more fun application to be doing. When I got it, I was like, well, this is an amazing opportunity. I should definitely do it. And I have so much to thank for the teacher who sent out that a mass email to all the kids in our class with this study abroad opportunity. And I think it really is, the role of teachers is not to be underestimated in how influential they can be in students' decisions for their future. I think had that political science teacher not sent out that email, I wouldn't have ever applied, and I wouldn't have ever thought that maybe I didn't want to immediately go to college right after high school. And I think that was one of the most influential emails I ever opened.
Wow, that's a beautiful story. So that shows that teachers play a huge role in getting the word out. Anybody else, how did you learn about the program?
I learned about the program from my. Oh, sorry. I learned about the program from my Chinese teacher, actually. I picked up Chinese fairly late compared to other people at my school, because it was offered starting freshman year. But I didn't start the learning Chinese until my sophomore year of high school, at which I decided, might as well just try another language to see how it goes. And during the first year of that class, or actually the first semester, our teacher introduced us to opportunities to go abroad to study Chinese, because she acknowledges my teacher was herself went abroad to study Chinese when she was in college. And so she knew of the importance of going to another country to really gain an in-depth understanding of the language. So she really highlighted a lot of different programs that you can go through to go abroad and study Chinese. And so I just decided, well, you know what? Going abroad to study Chinese, it doesn't sound half bad. And so I ended up applying to the program, and I didn't even expect to get accepted, and I got accepted, and I just decided to go for it. And it was definitely one of the best decisions I've made in my life. So I was very thankful to that and the U.S. Department of State to providing such a tremendous opportunity.
Great. I think the U.S. Department of State is happy to hear you thank them for this. Anybody else?
At my high school, there's always been AFS exchange students, and my sophomore year, there was a girl from Germany on the reciprocal program of CBUIX in America, And she encouraged me to apply to go abroad just in general, and then told me about CB, and I fell in love with the program. My teachers were super supportive. The administration was obviously a little questioning the credit transfers, but like I said, I had my history teacher and my Latin teacher were overwhelmingly supportive and helpful with recommendations and everything like that. And that was just super awesome to have people that were into the program as well. But I think that hosting students in your own community, it makes it really, helps build the program as well. So I think that's another great thing to bring into U.S. high schools if you don't have an AFS program or something like that, to try and initiate it and get host families, because I know that it's hard to find host families for any program, but they have such a great impact on the community and other students. So that's my push for hosting.
Again, educators, because this webinar is for you, you hear the students telling you over and over that having an advocate is so important. Having that one teacher send that one email to a class of students can radically change their lives. Best experiences of their life, they've said. Anybody else? Jill, do you have anything you want to say after hearing these positive comments about teachers and counselors?
Yeah, absolutely. I just want to leave everybody with the thought that, you know, even if your school doesn't have one of these, like if your school doesn't have Chinese, that I don't want educators to think that they can't still promote these opportunities for their students just because the student isn't necessarily going to be able to continue that language study when they come back within the walls of the school, because these programs are so motivating and so inspirational for the students when they go and when they come back. They'll find ways to keep going and maintain, you know, their language skills, but there's so much more that they glean from the opportunity that it is not just tied to the language. So I just don't want any educator to ever feel like because they don't offer Turkish in their school or they don't offer Korean or Russian or whichever language is associated with the program, to let that be a deterrent from promoting these programs to students, because they're going to get and bring back so much more than just language. The culture and the global competency and the awareness and the maturity and the independence and all of these things that they're going to come home with are well worth, you know, sending that mass email out to the students, posting those posters up in the hallway, you know, putting those brochures in the guidance office, helping to bring in volunteers from the local community to share the information at any sort of, you know, college night or open house or, you know, international fair, any of those things. It's totally worth it. And each one of these students that we've heard from today is just the proof. And there's so many more of them out there that have been able to take advantage of these opportunities that, you know, we hope there's some from every school so that they can all have these ambassadors to share with the rest of their students to keep these programs going and to see the value.
And again, if you guys want to start sharing this right now, you can go to our website. It's exchanges.state.gov/high school. You can download brochures. You can download graphics. You can, again, email youthprograms@state.gov if you want hard copies. And this program is for everyone, all nationalities, all backgrounds. Rich, poor, this is for you. This is a free program. You can apply online. And as you can see, we have a great, interesting, diverse panel of students who've participated, whether they've graduated from high school, they're starting college. So as we're coming towards the end, we have about, you know, 6 minutes left. What do you guys want to leave? What's the call to action for educators?
So for me, the educators were like a huge thing for me. Like when I went abroad, all of my teachers were so supportive. Like, none of them really knew about the exchange program, and I had to, like, look it up for myself, and I had to find it myself. But then when I applied and I got in, all my teachers were really supportive. And I actually, two of my teachers, my history teacher and my social studies teacher, they actually Skyped me while I was abroad in Thailand, and I got to talk to my class, and I got to tell them about what I was doing and show them, like, a little bit
Like, I got to walk around my house and show them and introduce them to my family, and it was really cool not only for me, but also for my host family to know that I appreciated them so much and showed that how much that intercultural bond and what it was bringing, not only just to me, but what I was going to get to bring back to my community, because it is an intercultural exchange, and what I got there, I was bringing back to America. So everything that you learn there, you can bring it all home. It's not like you go there and you leave it there. You go there, you take it in, and you bring it back, and it really helps you in the future. And it really inspired some of my classmates to do summer pro. I actually have three friends that they didn't do year programs, but all of them went on summer programs, and they applied while I was abroad because I inspired them. And that was really cool because my town had never had never been exchange or anything like that. So it was showing the impact that one person has to have other people really go forward and want to do something like that. And that's really what it's all about, is that one connection can change everything. And so teachers, when you reach out to us and when you let us share our experiences and when you share what we could do, it really helps us, because not all students are willing to go out there and look for it. If it's shown to them, they'll go out and look at it. But it's really you that motivates us to do what we do, because you're in our lives every single day. And whether we want to say it or not, we definitely look up to you and we respect what you have to say.
Sounds like you started a movement. Anybody else? What's the call to action for educators and teachers?
Yeah, I might also add that I know when I was in high school, there was kind of like one path that was going to get you to like a successful career, like assuming that's like the end game. Like you're going to do really well in the SATs, you're going to take a lot of AP classes, you're going to study really hard, and you're going to go to college. And that was the path to getting where you wanted to be. And that was the path that a lot of teachers push us for. And I think there is a need to kind of rethink that and go to college, definitely go to college. But I think study abroad isn't something that necessarily a lot of educators, especially in high school in America, push for. I think that's something that should be more of a narrative that teachers advocate for, just because it is, even though it's a little bit off the beaten path, it is so beneficial, and just as beneficial as, I mean, to me, way more beneficial than doing really well in the SATs, because once you're in college and once you're out of college, like what you got in the SATs won't really matter, but that year that you had when you were 18 will always matter.
You hear that? SATs alone don't matter. You need to be a well-rounded individual. Thank you, Anjali. I think that's important, because a lot of people feel pressure, like they may not be good enough, or they may not feel good about what they're doing because they're being measured by one standard. But here's a chance to really expand yourself and demonstrate that you can be a very competitive individual with other qualities. So we've got 3 minutes left. I really want everybody to say what they have to say so that everyone can hear their experiences.
If I could just add something, I think going off of what Jill said, all it takes for a student to have this transformative experience and to bring that sort of ripple effect of their experience back to the community after they return is just sending that one email with a link to the program application, or just having the brochures in your classroom for one day, or a poster in your classroom, or inviting that exchange student who's hosted in your school to come to your class and talk about the opportunities that Americans have to go abroad. It just takes a moment, and it can really have a big effect on the participant and also the community.
And to chime right in with that is to say, don't leave it to someone else to be the one to send that email or put those brochures up, because sometimes I think we get under that assumption that, well, no, somebody else is going to do this, or the foreign language teacher will do it, or whatever, and it just let it be you. I listen to all of these wonderful things that these students have said today and how much they appreciate that educator who took that one step of sending that email or putting that idea in their head, and it has changed their lives. And so, it is that reward of seeing them come home and see how much they got out of that experience that has to make it worth it. So just send that email, promote it however you can or however you're comfortable with, but don't save it for someone else to do.
So the call to action is send that email. Michelle Peters, do you have any last words, being the point of contact for all of these programs, all the communication materials?
Sure. I would just say, please email me. We'll send you whatever you need to help you promote. And also, we would absolutely love if you would advertise our next
Google Hangout, which is geared towards the students in your classrooms, or perhaps arrange a viewing party in your classrooms or auditoriums. That would be wonderful. The same panelists will be on that, so you'll see familiar faces.
So next week, we'll be here, Thursday, May 29th, 3:15 to 4:30. We'll have another discussion. You can tweet, hashtag, email youthprograms@state.gov if you have more questions. You've already met the students, so you know where they've traveled to. You have an opportunity to research the programs. So teachers, bring back your students. We'll have a more in-depth discussion next week. And thank you so much to the U.S. Department of State, the U.S. Department of Education, to all the wonderful students who've participated, to Jill for her contribution, to Michelle Peters, Michelle Nayland, and Yvonne Ribeiro-Yomufio for your help. I'll see you next week.